Now the attachments of the semitendinosus are more distal, means near the insertion, whereas the attachments of the gracilis are more proximal. Okay, so we are inserting this polyester or the ethibond inside the semitendinosus tendon and make a loop so that you can have a good leverage of tug on the tendon. Then we are trying to free the distal attachments near its insertion, okay, free of any remaining attachments with the sartorius fascia. You can cut out the distal end of the insertion with a knife, or you can give a smart tug with your finger to tear it off in the distal attachments. Both of them are fine. In this case, you give a smart tug with the tendon to tear it off. Sometimes it so happens when you tear it off, it takes a bit of periosteal sleeve along with the tendon, which helps in later healing of the tendon into the graft, the bony tunnels. Now, once we have that, we are now searching for the partial attachments. This is one of the partial attachments that we have found, and we have to cut it. Okay. If the tendon is not free, you are going to have a premature amputation of the stump, the tendon, and this is the second partial attachment. Okay. Usually, we have, as I said, 2 to 4 is the range, but 2 are the standard ones. After you have cut both the partial attachments, you have to insert your index finger and search circumferentially 360 degrees around the tendon, and you have to palpate at the posterior end of the distal end of the thigh to see that there is no kinking of the tendon as you pull along the tendon. So once you have made sure that there is no partial attachment, the tendon is free all around, then you can insert your open-ended tendon stripper and then go inside, and then with a gentle pull and push of the tendon stripper, and you have to keep pulling at the one ethibond end, and you have to go all inside with the tendon stripper, and then you have a good length of the tendon. So then we proceed with the bone patellar tendon graft harvest. So again, you have made all your marks, the ligamentum patellae, the patella, the tibial tuberosity. So after you have made the mark, what you have to realize is that the skin over the tibial tuberosity is not very mobile, but the skin over the patella is much more mobile. So you have to make your insertion in such a manner that it will be more near the tibial tuberosity, because you will not have leverage to retract the skin much. However, on the superior side, the skin incision will be much more mobile. It will act like a mobile window. You can pull it up and down. Okay. So once you have made the incision, once you have made the marks, so then you have to make a incision. The incision will be slightly on the medial side, because you do not want to go over the tibial tuberosity, because when the patient kneels afterwards, it will hurt his calf. And secondly, once you are on the medial side, you can make all your tibial tunnels, etc., through this same incision. Okay, so you have to dissect out the skin, then the subcutaneous tissue. In the same line, you have to incise the peritoneum over the ligamentum patellae. Once you have incised the peritoneum, you release the peritoneum up and down with the Mew scissors. And then you have to dissect out the entire width of the ligamentum patellae. Usually it comes to about 30 millimeters or 3 centimeters. We aim to harvest the central third of this, that is about 10 millimeters or 1 centimeter of width of the ligamentum patellae. This is the entire width that we have dissected out. We mark with the measuring scale the central one third, that is about 10 millimeters. Okay. So then we move up and we extend the incision of the ligamentum patellae over the patella, and we again put our measuring scale, and the patellar bone graft will be about 10 millimeters by 20 to 22 millimeters. Okay. You have to score the patella with the knife so that you know where to place your oscillating saw. And this oscillating saw is to be placed in a slightly oblique manner and not in a vertical manner into the bone, so as to avoid giving rise to a stress zone. And the second advantage of putting the oscillating saw in a slightly oblique manner is that usually the width of the patella is about 22 to 24 millimeters thickness. You want to stay ahead in the anterior half of the patella, so the thickness that you will go, that you will dive into the patella is about 10 millimeters. So if you go vertical, not only will you be making a stress-riser zone, but you will get a smaller length. But if you make an oblique one, the stress-riser zone will be less and you will have a greater length of the bone. Okay. The patellar bone plug is usually, the patellar end of the bone plug is usually inserted in the femur by making the ACL graft, and the tibial end of the bone plug is inserted into the tibia. The tibial end is about 10 to 10 millimeters into 25 millimeters. Once you have used the oscillating power saw, the distal and the proximal cusps to complete will be at about 45 degrees angle. Then you have to use a very sharp osteotome to prise open the bone plug from either end. Okay, this is just so this is the same video repeating over again. So thank you. Any questions?
Just repeat your question.
So the BTT, the BTT graft is harvested after the diagnostic scopy and everything, the debriding is complete, because it might lead to a loss of the fluid from that the gap in the tendon.
That is what Rajita said. The best way is to make the portal in such a manner that the capsule acts like a plug, so that the water can seep out.
Whether we use just a graft first, or you can go for diagnostic?
Yeah.
Yes, you can go for diagnostic.
You can go for diagnostic
first.
First,
first and then you can have the graft.
While you taking the PDB graft, you take care that the joint is not open.
Yeah.
Number one. And number two, after taking the graft and when you are positive for the next day, you have to
close
that layer. Otherwise, you cannot do scopy for plus.
No, it
doesn't
happen. Yes, it doesn't happen.
It will interesting. Whether you take a quadriceps tendon or you take a BTP tendon, I think it's always good to do your scopy first to find out about the ACL status that you want the graft. But you don't have to close anything before. You do not do water. The fat will just all the water.
Yeah, usually the capsule does not open. Even if you take the entire graft and you do a scopy after that, usually the capsule remains intact. But sometimes it might get damaged. In that case, you have to stitch it up to get the proper viewing of the joint.
Most important part for self zone that I will go for diagnostic scopy first, then harvest your graft. About the time you have seen it clinically, see the graft is the ACL is intact, and then just you have to use that graft. Always go for diagnostic scopy. The some ACL graft harvesting blues, quite common. We have premature amputation of the graft. So, what are the tips and tricks to get away from those?
Wonderful demonstration by Moina.
Yeah.
Teaches you everything. Now, if you can deliver the graft to such a length, we normally are very happy with seeing about 2 or 3 inches of the graft outside. We know we have there taken away all the inculin. But the way he has done, he's delivered about 5 centimeters, about 5 centimeters of it was outside. So if you can deliver that much, there's no way you will leave any inculin inside. And just make sure that you put in your graft harvesting, your tendon stripper. Because it was released so well, when you lasso do it without, and you don't do a baseball stitch like he did, if you have not released all your vinculin, quite often that lasso slips out. But when it's released so nicely, I think this was so wonderful demonstrated, this takes care of everything. You will never amputate a graft if you you have taken away all the attachments out, and be gentle about it.
Once you feel that your tendon stripper is hitting something, and it is not a simple, just a bit of soft tissue, then it will go inside, because that is what the tendon stripper is for. But if the tendon stripper is hitting something that you are feeling that the tug is not enough, then you have to remove the tendon stripper and go ahead and again dissect out. You getting my point? Secondly, if there is premature amputation of the stump, it so happens sometimes, you can use the scope to go inside along the direction of the hamstring tendons. And you can see the remaining of the graft. You can go ahead with a long straight arctic forceps and deliver it out.
So there are two ways out. First, what Manak told, you put your scope. Second is, don't remove your tendon stripper. Suppose it's a hollow structure. So you have amputated your graft here. Your tendon stripper is inside. So try to put your grasper through the tendon stripper. So most of the time it is at the tip or at the hole of the tendon stripper only. You can catch it. So never take it out. Otherwise, if you have taken it out, there is no way. You have to either put your scope inside, search for your graft, or you have to go for the posterior medial incision out. Sometimes to harvest the graft from this posterior medial incision.
Main thing is not to be very harsh. If it's not done, you have to have a feeling of either you are hitting a very hard structure or you are going hitting a soft structure. So if you are very gentle, and if you find that there is a resistance, there is no harm on removing it and giving a, you know, checking it once again, just go inside,
amputate,
put your finger.
I have already amputated it.
Yeah, you have amputated that.
We have all the others. In one of my case, I had to take the graft on the other side, and the patient was so unfortunate that he had an ACL tear on the other side, and he went to some other side, the GG Mursari guy. But then sir called me, why did you take the graft from the other side? Can you please explain it to me? Then I said, sir, this has happened to you. That's why I took the graft from the other side. And I
another tip, always take consent for graft harvesting for both ipsilateral and contralaterally, both one. Alright, always take consent prior, because sometimes you have a patient DSCL, but sometimes you decide for after years I have to go for MCL reconstruction also. So always take consent for, I think, contralateral graft harvesting also.
I think contralateral is good, but no one is happy to have an incision of the other. Should always be prepared if this happens, and this will happen to all of us, it will happen to all of you. Very few of you, trust me, will be able to retrieve that truncated portion. Very few. I have never been able to get it. So, my bailout always has been quadriceps tendon. But let's say half the occasions, the one that I had, instead of getting it 4/4, it's about maybe 3/4, and I got another 2/4 from the gracilis, and it went up to 7.5, just about 8, and that did the job. But on a few occasions that I've had to resort to a different graft, it has been.
Last question is, how do you differentiate which one is semi-T, which one is gracilis?
As I said, gracilis is attachment is superior to the semitendinosus. The semitendinosus is distal. Secondly, the gracilis is a much thinner tendon. And the semitendinosus is much bigger, much stronger, it is distal. Okay. And the semitendinosus has two constant attachments. If you find only one attachment and you are trying to insert your tendon stripper, think again whether I'm missing one attachment or not. More often than not, there are two constant attachments to the semitendinosus. If you do not do away with both of them, you're going to land up in trouble. And that what I was talking about, the soft structure and the hard structure. If you are getting one soft structure, it is very easy to go inside with the tendon stripper and the tendon will get harvested. But if you are hitting one hard structure, stop, remove the tendon stripper, as Dr. Joshi suggested also, and look again whether you are missing some attachments. Okay, better to be safe than sorry.
So when you take both the semi-T and gastrus, and when only the semi-T? The only this is the criteria?
Happens all the time. Happens all the time. Just leave the gracilis there.
So you have a good diameter and then yes. 75 cm graft is there.
It is tendency to take the semi-T first, identify the length and diameter. If it is adequate, then you keep the gracilis. You don't harvest the gracilis. If you feel that semi-T alone is not enough, then you harvest the gracilis.
No, the question was, if you have managed to harvest both of them, it has all happens to me all the time. And it doesn't create any problems. If you have the gracilis, you're not using it, when you suture it, just suture it to the soft tissue.
So apart from that premature amputation, when would you harvest the graft from the other knee? Like if you're doing an isolated ACL injury, apart from a premature amputation situation, when would you harvest the graft from the other knee?
You would really have to find a definite reason for doing it. I would not mind one.
If I have to go directly with the, if I'm adamant of going with the
hamstring
alone with the MCL injury, so I'd love to preserve the hamstring of the same side, take the hamstring from the other side.
So with an MCL injury, you take a hamstring from the other side?
Yeah, but there is still controversy. This is not straightforward. That is my practice.
I'm not saying there is an ACL. You're not attempting an MCL reconstruction. You don't need an MCL reconstruction.
We don't have this, we have 46 from the leg question.
Yes, sir.
How? Why?
So, like, I'm a big girl in ACL thing, and I consider one of my friends, the patient who has a complete ACL with an MCL that was not completely gone, so he suggested that I take the hamstring on the other side.
That's all right, because he was protecting the MCL.
Yeah. That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, that's, because MCL, this is an icon, this is Yosemite is an iconic one. So a lot of people believe if you take the Yosemite out from an MCL deficient knee, you're going to be doing harm. Makes sense. So that's all right.
But in those cases, I usually go in with the quadricep.
Yeah, that's the current trend is not to harvest from the normal side, but the current thing is to take the quadriceps of the same side rather than.
So do you have a video of the quadriceps harvesting?
In case of premature amputation, can we take erroneous numbers from the same side?
Yes.
Except for in there is some controversy in this athletic population, don't try because that will be important tender for two of us. So don't take it in the athletic population, otherwise you can.
I think at the present moment, I think we should keep erroneous lumbus tendon either for multiligamentous injury or for revisions. The jury is still out about the long term.
I agree. There are BPTP also. We shouldn't forget that there are BPTP also.
We have to be a little more careful. It's so easy to harvest.
Yeah.
So easy, such a juicy tendon, so easy to harvest.
And that one is now is popular also. And you don't have any kind of graft amputation in peroneus. Never. Because it's
any
it's
if you harvest peroneus, it gives you a wall. Big graft.
Sir, any tip to preserve the tennis branch when you're harvesting hamstrings?
Anything to preserve it? That is why the vertical oblique and then almost the horizontal incision has been advised. Yeah, so that we can less damage to the infrapatellar branch of the saphenous nerve.
Which one is best?
Oblique, there are studies, I have published my own study, there are studies from India that say that probably oblique has a lesser chance, even if there is IV. Infrapatellar branch is injured, the recovery is more in case of oblique incision rather than the vertical.
In spite of that consular patient, there may be some amount of plasticity or hypostasy of the acromedial aspect of the knee. And this is quite common. Even if preserve it also because of the retraction of the retractor, there is hypostasy and plasticity. I think 10 of the 5 patients will come in your OPD not because of the
10 out of 10.
10 of the 10 with this hypostasy problem. 10 of the 10. Yeah. This is a normal finding you will get after
this. Yeah, but gradually it will go away.
Yeah, about 8 months time it will
go away. So I think we are ready with the structure.
Good morning. My topic is the tunnel placement in the ACL reconstruction. So tunnel placement in the ACL is a very important step. Friend, believe me, one should spend at least 1 or 2 minutes to identify your anatomical landmark before putting your final tunnel. Because it has been seen that is the tunnel place at the wrong tunnel placement at the wrong place is the one of the most common cause of the your failure of the ACL reconstruction in the future. So there was a study done by the Merchant et al. The series was comprising of 112 cases. Out of 112 cases, the 83% of the cases was done by the transtibial technique, and that was the commonest cause of the failure of your ACL reconstruction. And he saw that 88% cases there was the graft was in the non-anatomical position, In the 61% of the case, graft was on the roof of the notch, and in the 35% of the cases, he saw that the ACL attachment was just posted to the actual tibial attachment of the ACL side. So the isometric concept, you can do the ACL reconstruction with having good range of motion, but the long-term track is not so good. In the long-term study, there is a ligament deformation by the isometric concept. So author tried to define the concept of the isometric, but actually it doesn't exist because there is no point on the femur that has the fixed distance from the tibia on a single point of the tibia. So elongation always will occur in the isometric concept. So how to put the tibial tunnel by the isometric concept? You need to have the tibial jig, fix it the direction of the angle of the 45 to 55 degree, and put your MR on the debrided stump of the ACL. That will be 7 mm anterior to your posterior fovea or retroeminence ridge, and it will be in the line of the posterior border of the lateral meniscus anterior horn. And your MR, your bullet will be on the direction, your bullet will be in the anteromedial tibia. That will be the 4 cm below to the joint line and 2 cm medial to the pubic tubercle. Once you have find out your exact position on the debrided stump and in the femoral condyle, femoral shaft, then you need to drill it using the bead pin, and you need to check the impingement doing the extension test. If it is tunnel is too anterior, it will impinge over your notch. If it is too posterior, it will impinge over your native PCL. So it's always a good idea to put your tunnel in the anatomical position. So once you have made your tibial tunnel or you have drilled it, you can check with the X-ray or your C-arm. So your tibial tunnel should be in the direction in the posterior parallel to your Blumen set line. Here you can see this is the Blumen set line. Then your tunnel should be posterior and parallel to the Blumen set line. Anterior tunnel placement will impinge on the notch, and posterior tunnel will impinge on the PCL. So you may require nocheplasty to avoid this complication. You can do if it is impinging, and sometimes it is necessary to facilitate your accurate tunnel, tibial femoral tunnel placement also. For me, the ideal landmark will be like 1 or 2 mm anterior to posterior border of the anterior horn lateral meniscus, and 1 or 2 mm medial to your exact tibial midline of the tibia. So how to make the isometric femoral tunnel? That will be always by the transtibial technique. You need to have the femoral offset guide that will pass from the tibial side, and the tunnel will be the on the over the roof position, over the top position. That will be the 6 to 8 mm anterior to trabec wall. That will be the at the junction of the roof and the lateral wall of the intercondylar notch. Here you can see this is the femoral offset guide. Here you need to pass it through the transtibial technique. Here you can see it has come out from the tibia and then put over the roof position, over the top position. Here you can see that is over the top position. So in the transtibial technique, you don't have too much space to play. You need to go through the transtibia. So that will be the incorrect femoral side position, and your graft will be from PL to high M position. That will be vertical, and there is the tunnel made by the transportal technique will be the longer in compared to your anatomical position. And the tunnel made by the transtibia will control only AP anteroposterior stability, not the rotational stability. So which bundle of the ACL is more isometric? That is always controversial. Some say if you reconstruct the femoral and tibial attachment side of the AM bundle will be having least amount of strain. Some say that PL bundle is more isometric. It is always controversial. Nowadays we have shifted from isometric to anatomical position. If you put femoral tunnel position inside the anatomical footprint of the ACL, so result knee kinematic will be closer to the native ACL in compared to if you are putting the tunnel through the isometric technique. So anatomical tunnel ACL reconstruction will be having control both on the AP and both and as well as rotational stability, and there will be the less chance of develop osteoarthritis in the future. So it's better idea to put your tibial or femoral tunnel through the anatomical technique in compared to your isometric position. So the principle of the anatomical ACL reconstruction will be either you are doing single bundle or double bundle. The main idea will be, the main objective will be to attain the maximum number of the but maximum percent of the ACL native attachment side. So what you require to make a tunnel by the anatomical method, you need to have three portal technique. So standard, we are using the anterolateral and anteromedial portal. Anterolateral portal will be the same, 1 cm below and lateral to the joint line. That will be main, that will be your main viewing portal. So anteromedial portal will be 1 cm below and medial to the joint line. That will be your viewing portal and that will be your main working portal. And sometimes you may require to see the your femoral tunnel from the anteromedial portal. And friend, believe me, this is the not the standard portal, but one should use the inframedial portal to make to be a comfort zone for while making the femoral tunnel. So before debriding anything, you need to find out the footprint. Once you have find out footprint, you can go ahead either nose plasty if required. But in if you are using the anatomical method, I have never done the nose plasty by doing the anatomical reconstruction. So you, then another step is that you need to identify the osseous landmark. So that will be the lateral intercondylar ridge, and the another will be the bifurcate ridge. Lateral intercondylar ridge run almost entire length of the ACL native attachment side. So there will be no fiber of the ACL above the intercondylar ridge. So that intercondylar ridge will decide the high or low position. So that will be the high position just above to the intercondylar ridge, and that will be the low position, that will be two posterior. So one should go posterior and deep to the that ridge. Once you have identified the bony landmark, you can measure the native attachment side by the ruler technique, and the proximal portion will be the deep position, and that distal position will be the shallow position. So our TBL femoral tunnel placement side will be the deep to the that position. So now come to the clock concept. If you are doing the reconstruction on the right knee, one should choose the 9 or 2 or 10 o'clock position. And if you are doing reconstruction on the left side, one should choose the 2 or 3 o'clock position always. Because it has been seen that 10 o'clock position more effectively resists rotational load in compared to if you are putting your tunnel on the 11 o'clock position. So here you can see this is the vertical tunnel, and one should choose the 10 or 11 o'clock position for the right knee and 2 or 3 o'clock position for the left knee. So that will be the exact location for the your femoral tunnel placement. So one should go posteriorly and deep in midway to the actual attachment side. If you are putting your tunnel too vertical, it means it will be higher, so there is high chance of impingement. If you are putting your tunnel too low, then there will be a chance of the high tension on the graft. So by the transportal technique, you can do the BTP, you can do the hamstring tendon, but revision ACL reconstruction is very cumbersome. It's not so easy by the revision ACL reconstruction by the transportal technique. So the another concept is the femoral tunnel position. One should follow the ideal position. I4 isometric, D4 you need to replicate the direct fiber of the ACL, or third one is the eccentric or the equidistance. So your tunnel should be in the equidistance between the deep to shallow position. So that the green mark is the ideal, the below to the green mark is the ideal position for the femoral tunnel attachment, femoral tunnel placement. So here you can see there is a no impingement if you are following the ideal principle. So my tunnel for the ACL will be the just posterior to the intercondylar ridge here on the femoral side, and the tibial side it will be the 7 mm anterior to the posterior fovea and the line of the posterior of the lateral meniscus. So in conclusion, the femoral tunnel should not be too wide. If it is too wide, then it means there will be a chance of the impingement. If it is too low, there is the chance of the blow out, or it will have the higher tension, and you should go deep into the notch, and you should follow the ideal principle. The complication of femoral tunnel, if it is too anterior, it will impinge, then the solution is the nosplasty. Sometimes if you are going too posterior, you may blow out the posterior cortex, then the endo button is provided, that is called direct button or the extendo button by some companies. You can use to avoid this complication. in the by putting the tibial tenon, you may put the two anterior, then it will be the notch impingement, you can do the notch plasty, but one should follow the ideal anatomical landmark before putting the bout tunnel. So thank you very much. Any questions?
The length of the femoral tunnel.
So ideally for me it should be around 35 to 40. But one should follow the exact principle. You should go deep and the midway. You should go to posterior from the intercondylar edge. If you are too anterior, then your tunnel will be very length, longer one. Or either you are using the transtibial technique, so your tunnel will be the vertical and the length will be around 50 to 60.
This depends on the flexion in the muscle.
And you should follow the hyperflexion while putting the femoral tunnel. It should be around 130, 120 degree.
Anatomical reconstruction, I believe it depends between 35 to 45 depending on the size of the patient and size of the condyle also. So it should not be less than 35, means you are too low. If it is more than 45, either you are too high or you are or sometimes you have made a vertical tunnel, then you go to 50, 55 like that. So it should be between 35 to 45.
Thank you.
Any more question? One question with Kanchan sir, Amit. We are just roaming around this intercondylar notch for I think decades. From high we can go now we are coming to ideal. So Kanchan, what are the tips for ideal femoral footprint? Ideal femoral tunnel. I think
you still don't know what to do. That is
real.
I think you still don't know. I agree with Cross Warren. The biggest mistake I ever made in all these years of ICM was get taken by this anatomical attachment and coming low down. And that was the first time I had about early failures in about 10 or 12 cases. Still I saw the Scandinavian before with the cases. There were a very high number of early failures. So that was the only change that I made drastically and I really warned my fingers. And I think everybody is going very close to where we started. And this tells me a very interesting story about Freddie Fu's first treatise on double bundle. So he had asked H.R. Eriksson, who was the grand old man of Swedish arthroscopy, and one of the first people in Europe to do arthroscopy, to write the foreword. And I read the foreword, and it was so illuminating. Eriksson said, you know, I have been away from the ACL industry for some time, so I went to Springfield for the ANA lab, skills lab, and I attended 6 ACL reconstruction workshops back to back, which means I saw 12 ACL surgeons. And I asked each one of them, where do you put your femoral tunnel? I got 12 points. So now we have 12 points on the femur and about 6 in the tibia because there was not much digestion of tibia. So that you've got 6, 12 on the femur, you've got 6 below. And now Freddie gets this good.